Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's event. We're delighted that you could join us. I extend a very warm welcome to all of our staff, our students, our alumni, and our supporters who are across the UK and indeed around the world who are joining us tonight. You are very welcome to be here. Thank you very much for joining us. For those of you who don't know me, I am Professor Russell Bentley. I am the head of the Department of Politics and International Relations here at the University of Southampton. So on with our event. I'm going to say something that I don't think I need to say to anyone, and that it has been an unbelievable, a truly incredible 12 months that we've been living through. The pandemic has upended a lot of things that we took for granted in our lives. It's changed the way that everyone around the world has been living. But we have also witnessed an unprecedented election for the President of the United States throughout 2020, which has consumed a lot of people's attention and has occupied a lot of news coverage. No one has been closer to these extraordinary events than our speaker tonight, and I am delighted to welcome back to the University of Southampton, Jon Sopel. This is Jon's third talk at the university and his first time joining us since 2017. He is a highly respected member of our community, and we are honored that Jon is a Pro-Chancellor of the University of Southampton. He's also a graduate of the university. He completed his BSc Politics and Sociology degree in 1981. After Jon graduated, he was elected as Student Union President at Southampton. He continued to contribute directly to the university for 2 years, and that led him to his professional career in broadcast journalism. In 1983, he joined BBC Radio Solent as a reporter and a producer. I dare say the studios are probably not as posh as they are now in 1983, John. This launched his career in political reporting for the BBC, and in April 2014, John was appointed the BBC's North America editor. I don't need to tell you that it was through John's eyes that we watched the waning days of the Obama presidency, and it was through John's eyes that we witnessed the emergence of, the campaigning style of, and ultimately the presidency of Donald Trump, which no doubt could not have been more different from the presidency of Barack Obama. This means from his vantage, John had a front row seat to the most talked about presidential race in history, and indeed the most talked about president in history. Everything from Trump's Twitter spats and tragic and shocking events in the United States, John has reported on all of them. Now, the day by day and the blow by blow of the 2020 campaign is captured in John's latest book, which I have here. Unprecedented, Politics, Pandemics, and the Race That Trumped All Others. Outstanding title for a really amazing presidential campaign. We're delighted that John could join us and to talk to us about that and the wider experience of covering Trump and the race for the White House. John, albeit virtually, we're very pleased you could join us. Welcome.
Russell, thank you so much. And to students, staff, can't wait to get back onto campus. I'm sure it's been a bloody difficult year. Hopefully that light is there at the end of the tunnel, and I can't wait till I've got some reason to be back on campus for graduation ceremonies or whatever, and life getting back to normal and doing the things that students should be doing and all the rest of it. So well done for all your forbearance and the way you've adjusted to this awful year.
I certainly don't think you're going to have anyone object to the idea of returning to campus. I think people are chomping at the bit. John, let's get started with our questions. I'd like to start by looking back, if we could. It's still very surprising to many people that Donald Trump won the Republican Party nomination in 2016 and then went on to win the presidential race in 2016. Perhaps no one's more surprised than Hillary Clinton still that he won in 2016. What do you think it was about the mood or the political climate in America in 2016 that led to this odds-defying victory?
I can dress this up academically, or I can give you the sort of person on the street answer. I'm going to try and give you the person on the street answer first, and then we'll maybe a bit more. Look, people were just fed up. They were angry. They felt that Washington had let them down, and attitudes towards government in the US are fundamentally different, I think, than attitudes in the UK. In the UK, we say as a default question, what on earth is the government going to do about it? And in the US, they say, what on earth has it got to do with the government? And Donald Trump tapped into that unease, resentment, the Washington swamp, the fact that these politicians did nothing. And here was this shiny reality TV star. Yeah, he didn't tell the truth completely. And he may have, you know, dodged his taxes a bit and may not have always been truthful to his wives, but he seemed to speak the language that many people wanted to hear. And he was politically incorrect, and people like that. He suddenly was connecting to a swathe of American opinion that were probably not going to go and vote in 2016. And he motivated them to come out. And he did something that the Republican establishment said was impossible. The Republican establishment at that time was saying, we've got to appeal more to Latinos, and we've got to appeal more to African Americans, and we've got to appeal more to college educated women. Donald Trump thought, you know what? There's a whole section of the American public that are not registered to vote. We get them to register and I will win. And he did. That's the simple on the street. And there were very simple messages. I'm going to build a wall. I'm going to keep Muslims out. I'm going to make immigration tougher. I'm going to bring back manufacturing jobs. There were a series of very catchy, easy to understand top lines. Now, there was no second line or third line or fourth line or fifth line with Donald Trump. Hillary Clinton had a series of second, third, fourth and fifth lines, but could not articulate to the American people what she was for. That's the glib overview. I think fundamentally, America has always worked on the idea of the American dream, that with your hard work and playing by the rules, you will advance and you will do better than your parents did. And you will advance and you'll go to college and you'll get a better job and a higher paid job. And so you will keep climbing up. And I think after the 2008 economic collapse, it seemed that that had fossilized. The steel jobs weren't coming back in Ohio. The coal jobs weren't coming back in Pennsylvania or West Virginia. The textile jobs weren't coming back in Georgia. And people felt an anger and feeling let down. At the same time as the political leadership was going on about globalization and trade deals, isn't it fantastic that in Brazil, Russia, India and China, the so-called BRIC countries, there is a burgeoning middle class that we can sell our products to? Well, yeah, except I'm out of a job now. And it seemed that only Donald Trump understood their concerns. So to be honest, I was not surprised when Trump won in 2016. He had a clear set of ideas. There may not have been substance to those ideas, but they were catchy and he engaged the American people, and Hillary Clinton did not.
That is fascinating. There's a memorable moment where you're interviewing, that I recall, interviewing some Trump supporters, and you asked them what's so appealing about Donald Trump. And they said, he says things that other people are thinking. That's really fascinating. That's the climate, and those are the circumstances in which Trump triumphed in 2016. But surely there's something about the person as well. And I think a lot of people like to ponder, is he really what he seems when we see him? Or is this a shrewdly exaggerated act? Is it Donald Trump the character? Or is that Donald Trump? What's your take on the man?
He's immensely complicated. And I think you see all the aspects. You were kind enough or cruel enough to talk about how long my career is and how old I am. But I've covered politics for 35 plus years. I have never seen anyone close to Donald Trump in any shape or form. He is also the most transparent politician I have ever reported on. In that, with his Twitter feed, he's now banned from it, of course, I knew what he was thinking at any given moment. I knew whether he was gleeful. I knew whether he was resentful. I knew whether he was angry or sulking. You knew the mood. You knew what had had triggered him. You could see when he was boastful. You could see, you know, I'm the best, I'm a very stable genius, or, you know, no one has been treated as cruelly as me. And there, and I think all those bits, he is attention seeking. He wants to be the center of every story. He doesn't discriminate, I don't think, that much between being talked about and not, you know, I think Donald Trump does subscribe to the view that there is no such thing as bad publicity. I think that, and he surrounds himself with people, and maybe we're going to come on to talk about this, who will say what he wants to hear. Even down to, I was at the White House briefing room when his physician, a guy called Ronnie Jackson, came in and said, oh my God, if he'd only he'd eaten a bit better, he would live till he was 200. You can imagine how much Donald Trump loved that. They gave figures about his weight and height, which honestly, if he was a 24-year-old quarterback playing for the Patriots, you'd believe it. But when you say that he was this weight and that height, I'm not so sure. So even the doctors would tailor what they were saying. When he had COVID, the doctor then, Sean Conley, when he stood outside the Walter Reed Medical Center in Bethesda in North Washington, he wasn't addressing the world, though he was. He wasn't addressing the American people, though he was. He was addressing Donald Trump and saying what Donald Trump wanted to hear. And that is the man. He is complicated. Would I say he's narcissistic? I don't want to ascribe things because I'm not my job to diagnose these things. But are there narcissistic elements to him? Absolutely there are. Is there paranoia? Yes, there is. Is there bullying? Absolutely. Is he boastful? Completely. He is a complex individual, but we always knew where we stood with him. I think he would be the world's worst poker player because he cannot hide what he feels.
That is fascinating. So anyone who wants to know what Donald Trump is thinking really should just read his Twitter feed. Absolutely. That's really interesting. That feeds into something else that we couldn't have failed to notice. It was hard not to be amazed that Trump's style of governing, I would say, is unpredictable. Probably the least predictable president. Fickle might be another way of putting it. But it was a style of governing, and governing did take place. Do you think that the style distracted us from the changes that he was bringing about in American politics? And indeed, I want to say in politics around the world, because of the global influence of the United States. Did we miss a lot of what was going on because of the persona that Donald Trump is, doesn't even put on?
Look, there are times when I think he is absolutely genius. And I think that some of the political moves he pulls off and his ability to tune into the mood of the American people or the base that is he thinks is going to get him elected. He has his finger on that pulse instinctively, whereas a lot of politicians need, you know, quantitative polling and qualitative polling, and they need focus groups and all the rest of it to work out where people are. Donald Trump had it by feel. And, you know, you could say some of it was nasty. I mean, the whole, you know, when he railed against a black American footballer taking the knee during the national anthem, which is now takes place before every soccer match in the UK. Football match. I realize I'm in England now. I can use the word football and not be misunderstood what I'm talking about. You know, Donald Trump is very particular in that. And so I think at times we got distracted. I think that, you know, at times he would throw a shiny object there and we, the press pack, would go scurrying after it. And then, oh my God, what's happening on the other side? Equally, Donald Trump would have good news to announce and he'd get himself into a pointless spat with somebody. So I remember this when, for example, they did the USMCA, the US-Mexico-Canada trade agreement that, you know, was Donald Trump's first big trade renegotiation. And it was a big news story. He came out to the White House and he picked a fight with somebody and everyone reported on the fight and not the newly negotiated trade deal. And I would imagine his advisors were furious. When he fired James Comey, the director of the FBI, which led to the appointment of a special counsel investigation, that all happened because Trump screwed up the messaging. The White House came out and said, the reasons why Comey has been fired are A, B, C, and D. And Trump comes out and says, well, it was the Russia thing. I just wanted him to stop that Russia investigation. Hello, that's different. And he gets in the way. I think that though the rest of the world were pretty clear that Donald Trump was impulsive in policymaking and would just do things on the hoof. And then everyone's looking around thinking, holy crap, what has he just said? Oh my God, we don't know anything about that. And the number of times I heard from White House officials of, you know, and they, I woke up to his Twitter feed to think, what's the news story I'm going to do today? And I think chiefs of staff woke up and thought, what am I going to have to undo today as a result of something that Donald Trump has said? And whether it's on NATO, World Health Organization, support for the UN, climate change agreement, the world was pretty well aware where Donald Trump stood on all these issues. Very quick anecdote, if I might. I bumped into a senior European diplomat who lives near me in Georgetown in Washington. And I said, so, and this was a couple of weeks ago, I said, so how is it? What's it like with the new guy, you know, dealing with the Biden administration? He goes, oh, it's fantastic. I mean, upside and downside. Fantastic that there is a chain of command, there is discipline, there is order, and there is predictability. And I said, and what's the downside? He said, there is discipline, there is predictability, there is chain of command, and there is order. In the Trump White House, you could, if you were a senior diplomat, more or less get put through to Donald Trump directly with very few links in the chain that are going to protect you from doing that. So I think that Donald Trump is impulsive. His policy making was unique and will never be repeated again. There was no chain of command. But I don't think the rest of the world was oblivious to it. And I think that the American people weren't oblivious to it. I think that, you know, that they are, the American people are well aware of what he did, and some absolutely loved it. And as we saw in November 2020, more people loathed it and were determined to get rid of him come what may.
It was a very strange time. There's an enormous amount of churn as well in his administration. People in very senior positions being changed on fairly regular bases. Just extraordinary for the short, I mean, when you look at 4 years, how many people came and went during the Trump years. That's certainly one of the memorable things about it, I believe. But there are a lot of memorable things that came out of the Trump administration, and some of them might end up being legacies of Donald Trump, whether he wants them to be or not. Fake news might be one of the most enduring phrases to come out of the Trump years. And this one, this might hit a little bit close to home, but as a journalist, how has this kind of accusation affected public confidence in political reporting? Has it changed the way you conduct political reporting? Do you feel you struggle for credibility because of this?
Look, Donald Trump can accuse us of what he likes. I think that there were sections of the media. Actually, I'm just going to distract myself, which is something that happens, but forgive me. You talked about the sackings. My favorite sacking, because I've watched this all so closely. You know, it's like a fine wine. Was this a good sacking or an average sacking? The sacking of Rex Tillerson was the absolute genius one. When he was Secretary of State, he's on a trip to Africa. He's flying back and Trump fires him on Twitter. Except Rex Tillerson is old school. He does not have a Twitter account. And the plane lands at Andrews Air Force Base, or Joint Base Andrews, as it's now called. His aides who are with him on the flight turn on their phones and think, holy, Trump has fired the boss. Which one of us is going to tell him he's been fired? And that was the conversation that his senior aides had to have when they touched down on this trip from Africa, because in mid-flight, the president had fired him on Twitter. Anyway.
So, I mean, that's the president and CEO. That's Trump all over, isn't it?
He's got the authority to fire him. That's Trump running a family firm and not a proper business. So going back to fake news, look, or fake news. That was my Trump impression, by the way, everyone. Promise you won't hear it again. Well, maybe. he could call us whatever he liked. I think that some people, some of the American networks, were triggered by what he did and said, and found themselves taking up the cudgels as if they were the opposition to the President of the United States. No, the Democratic Party or sections of the Republican Party are the opposition to Donald Trump. We are not the opposition. And the more that we take on the mantle of being the opposition, the more justified the charge will be that we are fake news. And so when, you know, I had this famous encounter with Trump at a White House news conference where I broke my word already. I'm going to do a second of Trump impression. We go, you know, I barely uttered a word. He goes, "Where are you from?" And I said, "Oh, BBC News, another beauty." And I said, "We're free, fair, and impartial." And I think that, you know, and I said it very politely, but firmly, because I think we are. I don't think it's our job to take sides. I think I'm there to hold power to account. Now, that doesn't mean, sorry, you've got me on a hobby horse now, and I feel quite passionate about this. It does not mean that we are there to say, impartiality doesn't mean to say, on the one hand, on the other, only time will tell. Some people say 2 and 2 is 4. Some people say 2 and 2 is 6. Only time will tell. Some people say the earth is flat. Some people say the world. No, if it's untrue, say it is untrue. And I think that a lot of the time, the lies, the untruths, the misinformation was pretty harmless. But in 2020, it became epically serious when it is about the nation's health in a pandemic, and it is about the sanctity of US elections. And a big lie was told. And this isn't me saying it. I mean, this is not the BBC taking a view. The BBC understands that in the US Constitution, it is a country of laws. The laws are adjudicated by the courts. The courts have judges, many of whom had been appointed by Donald Trump. There was litigation about the election results taken by the Trump campaign. And depending on how you count it, 62 or 63 cases were brought, and 61 or 62 of them were rejected wholesale as worthless. So the courts have declared that the election was safe. The Attorney General has declared that the election was safe. The head of election security, a guy called Chris Krebs, who had been appointed by Donald Trump, lifelong Republican, had declared that the election was safe. The 50 secretaries of state that make up the United States of America had declared that the election was safe. Where is the evidence of fraud and the election having been stolen? And so, as tough reporting goes, you say that is not true. It is not true that the election was stolen, because all the official bodies of the United States of America have gone through the proper processes. It's been legally challenged and it has been found to be watertight. And I think that that calls on me to say it's untrue, but it doesn't mean I'm going to throw mud at Donald Trump. And I think the press has got itself into a bit of a mess over what its role is. Our job is to hold power to account. Whether it's Andrew Cuomo, the governor of New York, who finds himself in hot water now over the reporting of deaths from COVID, now sexual abuse allegations, or, you know, sexual misconduct allegations, I should rephrase that as, or whether it is Donald Trump, a Republican. It doesn't matter. Our job is the same, whether it's a Democrat or Republican, but I think some elements of the American media did go too far and were overtly hostile to the president.
Right. That's interesting. One of the things I noticed when I moved to this country is that British journalism had a different understanding of objectivity than American journalism, which always did seem to be on the one hand, and on the other hand, British journalists always seemed to be saying, this isn't true and here's the evidence that it's not true. It's fascinating to hear you say that, because I think on both sides of the Atlantic, journalism might be going in the same direction in that point.
I think, let's just pick up on that. I think our job is to inform. Our job is not to affirm. And at the moment, in the US case, I think you have channels that affirm your pro-Trump viewpoint, and that could be Fox or One America News Network or Newsmax or various talk radio shows. And they affirm those views. And if you are hostile to Donald Trump, those views will be affirmed by listening to CNN and MSNBC, which are more center to the left. And I just think that there's got to be a, and I'm not just shouting about the BBC being free, fair and independent. I'm talking about, you know, I think that Sky News do a very good job, and I think ITV do a very good job. And I think that the idea that we just feed people's predilections and just hear, tell them what they want to hear, I think that's really dangerous for the lifeblood of a democracy.
Thank you. Let's turn to the 2020 campaign period itself. Looking back at how Trump and his White House responded to the pandemic, how much, I mean, if at all, how much of this do you think doomed the Trump campaign? I mean, do you think he still could have pulled out a victory?
Yeah, I don't think, so if we had, were having this conversation a year ago, maybe a little more than a year ago, no, probably about a year ago, I would have said, I cannot see Trump losing this election. Economy was doing well. People felt they had a bit more money in their pockets. There was, you know, all sorts of things were going in the right direction. And if you looked at his, you know, dashboard, there was nothing in the red column. It was all looking pretty good, purring. The pandemic comes along and upends everything. He didn't lose the election because of COVID. He lost the election because of the erratic way he handled COVID. And I think it just underlined people's concerns. I was at the briefing when he started talking about injecting sunlight and disinfectant into the body, you know, and saying it seems to kill the disease stone dead on surfaces. Why don't we put it into the body? Well, because it will kill you stone dead as well, is the answer. I mean, I've got, you know, that night was just surreal because the briefing went on forever. Donald Trump hadn't been able to talk to the public in the way that he likes, which was via rallies, via having heads of state there who he just sounds off. And so he started coming to the briefing room on a regular basis. And there were only 12 of us ever allowed in the briefing room for COVID safety reasons. And I was quite often there. So I was almost having these intimate one-to-ones with Donald Trump during this period. And it was clear that Donald Trump was using the press, us, the media, to use the correct metaphor of the time. He needed oxygen. We were his respirator. Was there ever going to be a more tragic end to a relationship than him relying on journalists who've been his torturers to be his respirator? So it ended in tears. And so he just said bizarre, weird. I think as George W. Bush said of Trump's inauguration speech to Michelle Obama, that was some weird shit. And there was elements of what Donald Trump said and did during COVID about whether it's good to wear a mask or not. And then we had the whole episode at the end of the campaign when he contracted coronavirus. And I'm outside the Walter Reed Hospital when Trump goes on that COVID joyride. When, you know, I'm suddenly looking down the street and I'm thinking, holy, that's the beast coming towards me at about 3 miles an hour. And inside is, I can see Donald Trump, yes, waving at the crowd that had gathered. And you didn't know whether it was him thanking the crowd or him needing the oxygen of the crowd. And so, you know, I think that that just cemented in people's minds, this has been an extraordinary ride, but the volume has been turned to 11, as in Spinal Tap. And we now need, instead of just heavy metal, can we just have some easy listening music, please, with the volume turned to 6? Can we have Mantovani strings? Can we have, you know, whoever? But we just don't need the drum and bass of Donald Trump with the volume turned to max.
Was there a time during the campaign, maybe not Trump, but those closest to him, when they sensed that the jig was up and they weren't going to win this one, and that it kind of hit home that at best it was going to be an incredible long shot, but that they had lost?
Yeah. Russell, I think that's a really interesting question, because I think that actually for a long period, they thought there's not a chance. The polls were so uniformly against them. And then Trump did something very controversial. He started having the rallies again on a full-time basis and was hurtling around the country with unbelievable energy. And I don't know how many people on this call have ever been to a Donald Trump rally, but I have to tell you, he is entertaining. You may transcribe the 10,000 words he speaks. And if they were handed to you, Russell, as a dissertation, you would say after two paragraphs, enough, I cannot read any more of this. But actually listening to him with the grievances, with the jokes, with the kind of stage act, with the pouting, coming on to YMCA, you know, I want to come into the audience and kiss you. I want to kiss you all. You know, I was at Sanford International Airport outside Orlando when he, you know, for a rally like that. It was his first rally back. And you thought, my God, he is good. Then they started believing that he could win it. But I think that once it was declared for Biden, when he won Pennsylvania on the Saturday after the election, and, you know, CNN call it and the others call it that Biden is the victor, I think that the senior staff at the White House knew it was up. And they were pandering to the president by saying, I kept on being told by people, he knows he's just got to come to terms with it. And once he's come to terms with it, look, we'll move on. We'll have a normal transition. You wait, we'll have a normal transition. We did not have a normal transition. There was anything but a normal transition. And so simultaneously, what happened on January the 6th was the most extraordinary thing I have ever reported on in 35 years, where I go on the television on the 10 o'clock news that night and say American democracy hangs in the balance. And I never thought I would utter a sentence like that. And two, if I did, I thought it would be totally hyperbolic, and it was neither. But it was also the most predictable, because for months, Donald Trump had only ever conceived of two possible outcomes to this election. One, that he won, and two, that it was stolen from him. And his supporters, who only ever listened to Fox or One American News or Newsmax or listened to the talk radio shows, they were getting that nonstop. That was the only thing. And so by the time you get to January the 6th, the crowd that we talked about at the start of this interview, Russell, when you talked about the woman saying to me, you know, he says what I'm thinking. There's no humour. There's no fun. They are angry. They believe the election has been stolen and they want blood. And at Congress, they got it.
That's fascinating, because I actually wanted to ask you about the 6th of January, because the election was lost by Trump and it was won by Biden, but it was anything but a peaceful transfer of power, as you said, from the end, the beginning of November to the 20th of January. I mean, unprecedented, extraordinary scenes. Superlatives fail me to describe the 6th of January. And I know you interviewed some people who ended up being amongst those who broke into the Capitol, which is a strange juxtaposition there. But it also seemed to, I mean, it shocked the American public, but it rattled the political establishment in some pretty profound ways. And it resulted in, as we know, something else unprecedented about Trump, the only president to be impeached twice. What I really want to get a grip on is, do you think there is now an unbridgeable post-Trump divide in America? Or did that shaking up, that sheer terror that a lot of legislators felt, is this now the crisis that restores bipartisanship in Washington?
So to your last point, I don't think it does bring back bipartisanship to Washington, because it's in neither the interests of the Democrats or the Republicans that they all hold hands together and start singing Kumbaya around a campfire. I think that they're opposing each other, the electoral cycles, midterm elections, November 22, onto the general election in 24, everything is geared towards differentiating yourself from your opponents. But is there an unbridgeable divide in the country? I'm going to give a cautiously optimistic answer. That's not because I think the danger has passed in American democracy. I remember Paddy Ashdown, you know, who was, after being leader of the Liberal Democrats, went to Bosnia and tried to sort it out. He described Bosnia as like a lemonade bottle that had been really, really shaken up. And you look at it on the outside with the lid on and you think, well, that's fine. And you take the lid off and phew, everything goes out. This week at the Capitol, they're intensifying security because of a QAnon theory. It's almost like the second coming. The QAnon people have decided that Friday is Donald Trump's return to power day. and that somehow he's going, and so they are intensifying the security around him. So look, there are still a lot of people with a lot of guns and a lot of malice and a lot of dark thoughts and a lot of conspiracy theories in their heads. And I think that provides a huge and present danger to the US. You know, remember the national security disposition of the United States of America since 9/11 has been that the greatest threat to the country is from outside jihadists from the Middle East. And now the understanding and thinking is coming around very much to the view that it is the threat of domestic terrorism that should keep people awake at night, and rightly so. That said, there's just been this conference that took place in Orlando at the weekend called CPAC, which is the Conservative Political Action Conference, which has also been dubbed now TrumpPAC because it's so loyal to Donald Trump. They do a straw poll at the end of it to find out how many people want Donald Trump to run again in 24. It's 55%. If this is the Trump loyalist base and only 55% want him to run again, it suggests to me that while there are sections of the Trump base, probably 30% of the American electorate are solidly behind him, that is a long way short of being in a winning position. Now, I believe the Republican Party has huge issues ahead of it as it emerges from this post-Trump era. And I'm sure that whoever they select to run in 2024 will have a very strong Trumpian flavor to them. I think it's unlikely that it will be Donald Trump. He's still got a lot of legal issues to confront. But I think that, and I saw another poll that was taken soon after Biden became president. And it was written in a very negative way, saying 10% of Americans say they will never accept Joe Biden as the legitimate president of the United States. And I thought, well, just turn that upside down. It suggests that 90% of Americans will. And that is progress from where we were on January the 6th, when the country seemed bitterly divided. So I think you've got Joe Biden at the moment doing everything he can to be efficient, respond to the scientific needs, get a stimulus package passed that is very popular in the country with Republicans, even though the Republicans in Congress are voting against it. Yes. Just lower the volume, just lower the temperature, and gradually let the healing process begin. That is Biden's ambition. I have no idea whether he will succeed, but that is clearly the name of the game that the Democrats are playing right now. Mm. America was at the brink on January the 6th. There is no doubt about that.
Mm. It was an extraordinary scene to watch. And like I said, your interview with people who soon after
were, well, So I was at the Ellipse when Donald Trump made that speech. The Ellipse is the parkland just to the south of the White House that goes down to the Washington Monument, for those who know Washington. And there are these guys, and they have got armor. I mean, it's kind of, I don't know what it was made of, fiberglass or something like that. Lightweight armor they were wearing. And I said, are you here for a fight? And they said, well, no, but if a fight happens. And then the next day, I see a photo of a guy hanging by one arm, about to jump from the parapet of of the balcony of the Senate onto the Senate floor, and that was the guy I'd interviewed. And they had stormed the
extraordinary,
Congress.
I mean, extraordinary,
yeah, absolutely.
Jon, this has been absolutely fascinating. Our audience have been asking questions very patiently. I'm going to stop asking you questions. I'm going to start taking some questions that have come into us, if you don't mind. But thank you very much for all the insights you've given us so far. We have a question from Richard Cartwright. He says, when Jon presented his first book during a lecture at Southampton, I asked him whether he admired Donald Trump in any way. At the time, he did. I wondered whether he still does, and whether what he admired has changed.
I think he's a great communicator. I think that he's kept his base strongly together. But I think that in politics, and it's a cruel old business, that you can do all sorts of amazing things. I mean, look at the Blair premiership. You know, he's prime minister for three terms. He brings peace to Northern Ireland through the Good Friday Agreement. There's the minimum wage. There's Sure Start schemes. There's all these other things that Blair would love people to look at him and say, that was my premiership. He's remembered for the Iraq War. You know, Bill Clinton, probably Monica Lewinsky. George W. Bush, probably also Iraq War. Barack Obama, he'll be remembered as being the first African-American president. Donald Trump will be remembered for what happened on the 6th of January, if there is the one thing that defines him. And I think that American democracy being taken to the brink on the basis because you cannot come to terms with the fact that you lost an election, I'm not sure how admirable that is. I admire his ability to connect with people. I admire the transparency of the man and the honesty with which he kind of expressed emotion and feeling. And you're not second guessing it through a series of press releases. And I admire his the visceral ability and the fact, look, you know, you may not like it, but like Machiavelli's handbook in The Prince says, you know, it is better to be feared than loved. And Donald Trump is feared by the Republican Party. And that is some political achievement, that you have got so many lawmakers who are terrified that if they say a word against Donald Trump, all sorts of trouble will come their way. So those are political dark arts that Donald Trump is very skilled in. But, you know, look, whether history will admire him or not, or whether I admire him or not, I think there are some very admirable skills, and I think there are real shortcomings.
Extraordinary thing, those of us who can remember the 2016 primaries for the Republican nomination, the Republican establishment did everything they could to torpedo Donald Trump's candidacy. So, I mean, it's one of the extraordinary things about him actually getting the nomination. Sue Holmes would like to ask, do you think Britain is so far away on occasions from Trump's type of populism? And how big a threat to democracy do you believe it to be?
Sue, I think that, look, obviously Britain has been through its own trauma in terms of the Brexit vote and the division that it sowed. And I think that it feels to me, and I live in America, so I'm back in the UK at the moment, but I'm back to America on Monday. I think that the populist forces are different. I don't think that they're the threats to UK democracy. You know, America came pretty close. You know, when I went live on the 10 o'clock news and said those things, there was a mob that had taken over the Congress and the forces of law and order had lost control. It looks, you know, in third world countries, that's where you see the coup happening, the coup unfolding. And I think America came very close to a very much more serious situation. Did Brexit ever get to that? There were a lot of very, very strong emotions, but I don't think the same forces are at play. And I look, you know, at the handling of COVID here, and I'll probably get into trouble for saying this, but I think there was a much more, this government may have been slow to react and at times making missteps, but I don't think there has been this sort of, oh, wearing masks, it's just political correctness, you know, and all this social distancing. You know, Donald Trump was holding, there were no sporting events taking place during the presidential election campaign, but the only mass population events were Donald Trump's rallies. He was absolutely flying in the face of the professional advice being given by the CDC, the Centers for Disease Control. And Donald Trump was just making it up as he went along. And I don't see those dangers. So I know that people draw parallels between Donald Trump and Boris Johnson. I frankly think they are overdrawn.
That's interesting. Donald Trump also, he railed against governors in various states who were doing more than the federal government was doing. Andrew Cuomo being one of them, where New York was locked down for quite a while. John, we've had a few questions about your very popular AmeriCast podcast. Jack Coyne would like to know whether podcasting has allowed a more in-depth style of journalism than traditional media.
And I know that someone is on, who's been part of this evening, has been helping out with the podcast, coming up with brilliant cartoons of me, Anthony Zercher, and Emily Maitlis, who do the podcast. I'm going to give her a plug. There you are. That's one of her cartoons of us doing our thing. Look, the podcast has been popular beyond our wildest dreams. And it's very interesting because the BBC has been going through all these kind of agonies about how do we attract a younger audience? And we're attracting a younger audience. I mean, you know, large numbers of young people, students, all sorts are tuning into the podcast. I think if you make good content and if you make it engaging, and it's so different from doing the 10 o'clock news or Maitlis doing her introduction on Newsnight and then the interview, it's much more conversational. We've known Emily Maitlis and I have known each other for a long time, so there's a fair bit of teasing of each other. And I just think that there is, people have changed, and maybe it's exacerbated by COVID lockdown, but I think that narrated and curated news bulletins, where this is the top story, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, 2 minutes on each, maybe a little bit of live in the middle, is a bit passé. And people want to drill into a subject with people who are not only going to be decent guides on the subject, but we're going to have some fun along the way. Go back to the old Reithian mission. When Lord Reith set up the BBC nearly 100 years ago, our mission was to educate, entertain and inform. I have always taken the view that if we're doing educating and informing as part of the process, it doesn't have to be like taking a really unpleasant medicine. You're not going to like it, but it's going to be good for you. So open your mouth and swallow. I've always thought, why can't we make this engaging? Why can't we try and make it talk to people in a way that will make them laugh? And so we have some fun along the way with songs in our podcast, and we have cartoons and we have all sorts. And it's just, it's a rich diet in which to talk about a subject. And, you know, and when we've heard from people telling us that they're planning road trips to go around certain counties in Pennsylvania that were critical in the election. I'm going to go to Erie County, and then I'm going to go to the Lehigh River Valley, and I'm going to go to, and I think this is fantastic. This is the stuff we've been talking about, and it's caught the mood. So I don't know what the alchemy is that we've come up with, but I think podcasting is really important, and the good podcasts are fantastic.
I think you probably explained what it is. There's a certain playfulness that you're allowed to have.
Yeah.
I'd be interested to know what people think they're going to find when they get to Erie County, Pennsylvania, but maybe they'll tell us when they get back. We've had quite a few questions come in about Americast, but I'm going to skip down if I can. Nigel Emery asks, is the world a safer place now that Trump is no longer president?
That's an interesting question, Nigel. Yes, no. I think that if you remember, cast your mind back to the early stages of the Trump presidency, we were all talking about there was going to be war in North Korea. It was inevitable. It was inexorable, the direction we were traveling in. And Donald Trump flies in the face of all his professional advisors and says, I'm going to meet Kim Jong-un. And they meet in Singapore. It doesn't yield anything, but it changed the atmospherics. Now, maybe historians will take a longer view and say, actually, he gave Kim Jong-un a break. The pressure relented on him. He built up his nuclear arsenal even more, and Trump got nothing back in return for giving Kim Jong-un this enormous platform on the world stage. I think it was a bold, daring, Trumpian move that no one else would have considered, and it yielded a certain result. We all laughed and sneered and mocked at Donald Trump suggesting that he would bring peace to the Middle East. Well, I know, people, he hasn't. But the fact of the matter is that the UAE, a very powerful player in the Middle East, and Bahrain have signed peace deals, have resumed diplomatic relations with Israel. The Palestinian problem is still to be sorted. Final status of Jerusalem still to be sorted. Right to return. I know there's a mountain of stuff that Trump hasn't done. But no one had signed a peace deal. There had been no Arab country signing a peace deal with Israel since 1994. Trump moved the dial on that in a direction that, you know, it would, if you're Israel and Donald Trump, you know, has got a very pro-Israel base in his country, not just among Jewish people, but about Christian evangelicals, which is a whole other topic. Donald Trump has done that. So I don't think that Donald Trump has necessarily made the world a more made the world a more dangerous place. His attitude towards Russia was bewildering. And it is one of the great unexplained, my two great unexplained things of the Trump presidency are one, Russia, and his attitude towards Vladimir Putin and why he was so accommodating. And the other one is hydroxychloroquine. Why did he keep going on about this anti-malarial drug as a treatment for COVID? It has no medical value, and yet he went on and on and on and on about it. And again, that's a bit of a mystery to me.
Yes, the Putin angle is particularly strange. He seemed genuinely fond of Putin in many ways.
I think he liked the character. I think he likes the idea of the tough guy.
Right.
He likes the tough guys more than he likes the Merkels or the Macrons or the Trudeaus or the Theresa Mays.
Right. Those are all the sorts of people who tried to keep him from getting into the White House anyway.
Yeah.
Esther Bombos asks, how do you envision the future of the Republican Party, the grand old party, the GOP, in light of current divisions? Are we looking at a lingering of the Trump legacy? I think you've said something about this, but what's going on inside the Republican Party, you think? Given 55% isn't a lot who'd like to see Trump run, but it's a big number for anyone else who might want to run.
I think that the Republican Party is sort of splitting in three directions at the moment. And there are two of the splits sound pretty much the same, but are different. There are the centrist Republicans, many of whom have abandoned the Republican Party and voted for Biden in 2020. And whether you can win them back, I think, will depend on whether the Republican Party returns to where it was. So that's one section. Mitt Romney is the obvious voice of that. Liz Cheney in the House of Representatives, another voice of that. They're conservatives. You know, Mitt Romney voted for Amy Coney Barrett to be on the Supreme Court because she's a conservative. He's a conservative through and through, but did not like the character of Donald Trump and the way Donald Trump made everything about himself. Liz Cheney, much the same. Those are the standard bearers for the old style republicanism. I might just put into that category Trump's former UN ambassador, Nikki Haley, who I feel absolutely certain is planning a run in 2024 and is my person to watch. But she, having criticized Donald Trump and attacked him for having led the Republican Party down the wrong path and the American people down the wrong path, and that he lost the election and had to come to terms with it, she got such strong blowback that she's trying to re-ingratiate herself with Trump. Then I think you've got where a majority of the Republican Party are, which is, I'm quietly behind, I just want Trump to go. I just want him to play no further, but I daren't say this out loud. Because if I say this out loud, I might find a primary challenger the next time my seat is up, and I don't want to say that. And then you have the hardcore Trump supporters or people who think that their best prospects for 2024, Ted Cruz, the senator from Texas, Josh Hawley, the junior senator from Missouri, clear calculation is to be the heir to Donald Trump and try to inherit the Trump base and the Trump machine so that they are behind you if you are lucky enough to win the nomination to fight in 2024. So, which is a long way of saying the Republican Party is in a bit of a mess because you've got the people who can't stand Donald Trump. You've got the people who just want Trump to disappear, but he's not going away, which is the rump, I would say. And then you've got the diehards who will fight in the last ditch. And it's not the same, but the nearest thing I can compare it to is what happened in the Conservative Party after Thatcher went. And you had the absolute ultras who were Thatcherite, who just thought the greatest betrayal has ever happened in British politics by getting rid of her. And it took the Conservative Party a long, long time to find its way back after, you know, the fall of Thatcher. Yes, there was the brief interregnum of John Major's government, but my God, what a mess that was in terms of the falling out and the challenges. And I think that's the nearest thing we've got as a point of comparison.
That's really interesting. I mean, Mitch McConnell has come very close to actually saying, I'm glad he's gone.
Yeah.
And maybe it's because he's senior enough that he can get away with saying those things.
And he's 78 and he's just won his seat back. So he's not going to be challenged for another 4 or 5 years.
No, and unlikely to run again, I think, in four or
yeah,
five
exactly.
years. We have some more questions coming in. A number of your fellow students from your time at the university here are with us this evening, I'm told, including Andrew Wolstenholme, who says, great
session. We were in Highfield Hall together, on the ground floor.
He says you're all together in Optimum Hall. He asks, what did the respective leaders of Russia and China really think of Trump? I think it's a fascinating question. I would like to know.
What did the Russian and...
The Russian and Chinese leaders, what did they really think of Donald Trump?
I think they indulged him, and I think they played him. And, of course, at the end, it ends up in a very sour direction with the Chinese. But if you go back to the end of January last year, Trump is praising President Xi for his handling of the pandemic and the transparency. Now, you could use a lot of words for the Chinese and their attitudes and what happened in Wuhan, but transparent is probably not one of them. But that was Donald Trump's early disposition, because he loved the idea of being friends with President Xi and President Putin. And I was at that news conference in Helsinki with Vladimir Putin. Again, one of those, some of the places, the things I've witnessed in these 4 years, unbelievable. Where Putin, where Trump is asked, do you believe that the Russians interfered in the presidential election? And which is the unanimous view of all, was the unanimous view of all the intelligence agencies in the US. And Trump says, well, I asked Putin about that, and he's reassured me that the Russian state did not play a role, and I have no reason not to believe him. Wow. So hang on. You trust Vladimir Putin more than you trust the director of the CIA, the head of the FBI, and anyone else. That's remarkable. And Trump had to walk that back the next day. And so I think that the Russians and the Chinese just thought, this is too good to be true. Now, Donald Trump was pressured into tough action against the Russians after the Salisbury poisoning. So there were times when he took tough action. But he always wanted to be on good terms with Xi, and he always wanted to be on good terms with Putin. And I think that the Russian leader and the Chinese leader probably enjoyed that hugely. And it was massively discomforting to Republicans and Democrats in Washington.
It's curious that he needed their affection in some ways.
Yeah.
We've had so many questions, and I'm not going to be able to get to more than one more of them. What would you think if Donald Trump expressed an interest in investing in your beloved Tottenham Hotspur football
team? Like we haven't got enough problems. That would be my answer. Like it's not bad enough as it is. I probably would join the petition saying, please, God, no. Because if you look at Trump University, Trump Meats, other Trump brands, I could not go. It would be called Tottenham Trumpland or something. He would have to have his name in the branding. It couldn't be that. And I say this with all due impartiality. I'm happy for you to run again in 2024, Mr. President. I'm happy for you to see if you can win again. That's fine. But please, leave Tottenham alone when we've got enough problems as it is.
The plea has gone out, Donald Trump. Please leave the football team alone.
Great question.
We are out of time. Thank you again, John, for your time tonight. I've had an absolutely fantastic time listening to you. Great stories and terrific insights. I know our audience have also appreciated this. You can tell from the questions. I wish I could have gotten to more of them. A fantastic window into the Trump presidency and the rise of Donald Trump.
Well, maybe
thank everyone in the audience.
Maybe we can do this another time.
I certainly hope we can. I certainly hope we can. Thank you very much to the audience for joining us, wherever you are, for your interest and for your support of the University of Southampton, for being fantastic members of our community. Thanks so much for tuning in. Our audience, if you have a moment, please stay and complete a short poll that we have. It will appear on your screen. It won't take you more than 2 minutes to complete. That helps us a lot. And for any of those who'd like to watch this again, there will be a link to a video of it made available to you. We'll send that to you in an email eventually. Also in that email will be an invitation to join our mailing list so you can be kept informed about future events. In the meantime, thank you to everyone. Thank you, Jon Sopel. Everyone, go home, stay home, think about what you've learned tonight, and have a very good evening. Thank you very much.